Ray is working with DEP to get funding to be able to extend public water to the people who have had contaminated water and been living on bottled water for the past 2 years.
Yeah, probably close to three, yeah.
Close to three. So this is a good thing. It's a good thing for people who don't know and have bottled water anymore. Some changes that, Westrock Hill, Stack, and things that we might want to change, but basically, PRA would like some input from you on the concept of the mandatory connection movement. So maybe that was, that's a good place to start the discussion, is having some comments from you guys.
Okay. Any comments?
No, I have gone through and checked all of the recent real estate sales. I have noticed that many of the properties didn't seem to mention on their seller property disclosures, they had sold this thing, and some had ultraviolet, some had mentioned, couple properties in the area mentioned that their wells were shallow wells, which are quite old and might need to have a couple or two. I actually said, well, you probably want to be drilling a new well. So I know that in addition to the dirt flow, aceto, in addition to the PFAS problems, there's also just a lack of water because you're starting to get up into the dyes where it's going to come again. And having water is a problem. We don't see any problem with actually running water up through that area.
Good.
Common sense. But my opinion, I've had interaction with several residents up there that have had these issues. You can't get a house with contaminated well. This all goes from the fire there that was at Burgess with the tires when they put the foam in. So we have to, as much as we hate to do the mandatory things, we have to make sure that the health, safety, and welfare, the water is safe and drinkable for the residents that live there. Is that a clear explanation?
That is a very clear explanation.
Okay.
One of the things that the proposed ordinance of CRA says is that connections will be made within 30 days. I wonder if you think that's enough time.
One of the things, too, since it's PennFest grant, all the connections are free to residents.
They are free,
so residents,
yes,
do not have to pay for
them. That should probably be noted.
If they do them right away.
If they do them right away.
If they deny, do not hook up now, they will not be free to live.
That's going to
be a problem. That's why if somebody becomes ill and has to sell their house, you can't sell your house with a contaminated well. So this is important to get it done.
Correct.
But it is important for you to point out that there will be no, I missed that, I'm sorry.
And the mandatory connection ordinance doesn't specifically state that, so maybe that would be a thing to put in the mandatory connection ordinance of the particular.
Right, yes. But I do believe, I don't know, 30 days. I think it's short myself.
90?
Yes, 90.
I do 120. Getting plumbing in to get the plumbing can take a while.
Because if the authority is paying for the entire thing, their authority contractor is making the connection to the house.
Okay.
So it shouldn't be a scheduling problem that everybody is getting their own.
Right. So let's rethink this now. Okay.
Just signing the name to the dotted.
That's all it is. It has no obligation.
Right. The connection. Through a person pending.
Would it be difficult to say 60 days?
Oh, I don't think so. I'm just saying it doesn't need to be extremely long.
All right.
Well,
we'll go with 60 MSD threshold goes with 90.
Okay.
We'll keep them consistent. So people on each side of the street have the same obligation.
That's fair. That's fair.
And then there's one more provision, it's a very short ordinance, page and a half, but there's another provision that notes that, and this will be a requirement, people should know that they're going to have to seal off their existing water. There will not be grant money available if the well is available to the property owner.
Oh.
So the ordinance requires that the existing wells be sealed and abandoned. and then there's a 60-day period for that, and it says that'll be done at the property owner's own expense.
It's gonna, okay, you said it. Property, so what are we talking about, what would that cost? A property owner, to seal off the well?
Yeah, I don't know, off the top of my head. Actually, I have to pull the pumps and connect in, so the ground, well, the trap.
We should have an idea, I mean, I'm not opposed to going forward with this, but we should know what that's gonna cost. What's that gonna cost the rest of it?
Yeah, we can actually get ready, because they might have an idea already, or someone lined up.
And then again, it says it has to be done within 60 days after the connection. If they have 90 days to connect, they probably should have 90 days to seal off the well after the connection.
Okay.
There's one of the properties along there which has a business, which I don't think uses water for dust suppression.
He's actually buying water, we talked about lapse landscape, he buys the water, he has the water hauled in, and he puts it inside of.
Mulching takes water.
Yes, absolutely, and he purchases it, this has cost him money, this whole thing for the last 3 years has cost him a lot of money, so that he could still sell his mulch, because he cannot use the contaminated water for the mulch, but it would be transported to everybody's house. So, this is a big deal.
It is a big deal.
Yes.
I understand, it's a big deal for everyone, if you're letting them buy the water, it's a big deal.
Yes, okay.
All right, thank you for the direction.
You got it.
I will move forward with PRA. The last two items on the solicitor's report are resolutions that, for the approval of a project that you reviewed last month. And the first one is the, I'm trying to figure out the purpose of this, or the cooking project, but, the first one is resolution 2023-9, which is the lot line adjustment. No, it is not, it's a lot line consolidation, and you reviewed it last month. I prepared a resolution in accordance with that review. If you want to move forward, we would be adopting resolution 2023-9.
Do you want to do them together or want to separate?
Let's do them together.
Aye.
And then the second one is the 50 lot line adjustment.
Right.
That's resolution 2023-10. You can make one resolution.
Okay. I'll entertain a motion for approval of 2023-9 and 2023-10.
So.
Okay. Mr. Collingwood, make the motion. Mr. Shermer, second. All those signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Ayes have it. Thank you.
Thank you. That's all I have for the solicitor's report. I'm just going to make sure I'll
make a motion to accept
okay.
The report as presented.
We have a motion made.
Second
it. Any discussion? All those signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. Thank you, Mary.
Thank you very much.
All right, next on the agenda is the management report. Greg, you're up.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The only item that I have is the Lawn Avenue detour. PennDOT is doing a Lawn Avenue project that will take 2 years.
Go ahead. Lawn Avenue is your detour. You know how many people use Lawn Avenue?
I do. And they are requesting to use Farmers Lane.
Wait a minute. Keep going.
And what they'll do
the
is,
climber is.
They will take a videotape of Farmers Lane, and after 2 years, they'll repair any damage. As long as we approve the detour. If we do not approve the detour, they'll send them over a PennDOT road. And if people just happen to go over Farmers Lane, then we'll be responsible for any of the damage.
So they will use Farmers Lane, whether we say make it a
yeah, but
or not.
Right. But
so
if we have something in place that we will be compensated, the road will be fixed.
We'll be protected.
Yes.
So my recommendation is for cars only, and that the truck detour be over PennDOT Road.
I like that recommendation.
Repairs for trucks, we won't be able to tell, so it won't matter.
Exactly.
All right, so you need that in a form of a motion, correct?
Correct.
Okay, I'll make that motion.
I will second. And I said, we don't think it's a good idea, but people are gonna drive that way anyway.
All right, motion's been made, second. All those signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye, ayes have it.
That's all I have for me.
Thank you, Greg. Next thing on the agenda here is old business, 729.
That is the fat tax place. You have for an update every month. And in your packet is the emails that we have received. They're continuing to work upon it, to take a look to see if it's eligible. They're still waiting for bank funding. You also have in your packet the structural engineer report of.
Well, they are working inside, because I've seen a dumpster there with a chute coming down. That's all stuff flying in there the other day.
They're in business there, aren't they? There's a trailer.
There's a trailer. They have a temporary permit for a trailer to stay in business after the fire.
Okay.
However, they are continuing to look. They are not rebuilding it yet, because they need a permit from the township. They're still waiting to see if it's structurally salvageable.
Okay.
I mentioned that, so I was surprised when looking back over that that is actually a brick building, so that raises my hopes of being able to restore most of it.
Okay. So that update is good there. The next thing I see here is 3115, Old State Road Zoning Hearing Board Letter of Opposition.
Yes, at last phone meeting, I informed the board of 3115 Old State Road. So our house is going on Old State Road. It needs a whole lot of areas, height, slopes, impervious surface, setback requirements. If the board so wishes, authorize the solicitor to send a letter to the zoning hearing board in opposition.
I would recommend that letter being sent in opposition.
I would agree.
So,
yes, sir.
So, I made the motion. Hal seconds it. All those signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Ayes have it.
Next item is the planning commission zoning update. That was given at last month. The board said they were going to table it. Didn't know if the board had any opinions or.
Well, we had asked Mary to give us some information regarding this issue, and there was some talk about Tinnick Township and being careful on pasting or following along with Tinnick Township. Some issues they had there. And I explained my position regarding not trying to take a property owner's right away from being able to build a house if a parent wanted to subdivide a lot off and it had these certain slopes and stuff that we don't try to take away someone's right to be able to build a house on a piece of ground that they may not have a big piece of ground, maybe a small piece of ground. And not that was the intention here at all. John Swerduff has done a tremendous research on what he was looking at there. So, Mary, the issue that Tinnickham has there, could you fill us in a little bit?
On their ordinance?
Yeah.
Their ordinance, because they're a river and he works there more than I do now. He's their engineer.
Okay.
So, they have a lot of steep slopes. They're a river community. They have overlay districts for recharge area, overlay districts for steep slopes, overlay districts for very steep slopes. It's a massive amount of overlay districts, and it doesn't work out the smooth implementation of schema zoning. Do you agree with me?
I would agree.
Comprehensive plan. You remember when Mike Roddick was in here and he was giving all these examples of Buckingham, Mayfield, Upper Mayfield, and I said, wait a minute, this is not Lower Mayfield, this is not Buckingham, this is West Rock Hill Township. The people up here want to live the way, we don't want to cut and paste and put something into our ordinances that represent the lower half of the county. That's not the way things are done here, or should be done, in my opinion. I'm only one person, but there was a lot of people that felt the same way. So I was kind of hoping that, and I don't know, John, what you know, the intent was here.
John Swart on 17 Ridge Valley. From the planning commission meetings over the last couple of months, we've seen an increase in requests to subdivide areas in the RC district. And with a 1.8 lot minimum size, a developer can get a lot of homes in a forest at 1.8 acres. That it doesn't look like a forest anymore after they're done. So there's been a lot of discussion with planning commission. I mean, I don't want to speak for any of the other members, but at least for one of us, there's a feeling that in order to try to protect the rural character and the natural environment of our community, 1.8 acres is too small in some areas. We discussed how we can do that effectively without taking away people's rights, without doing anything we shouldn't do, for lack of a better word. Suggestion was made that other townships, and maybe I use the word cut and paste, and if I did it was frivolous. Other townships have used protection measures through overlays in order to try to preserve woodland areas, farm areas, parts of their townships that they considered special or worthy of protection. So if there was any cut and pasting, it was cutting paste of the concept of modifying our zoning ordinance where appropriate for those areas of the township where we feel that overdevelopment would detract from the beauty of the township. It's not to prevent people from taking a part of their land for their future son-in-law or whatever.
Right.
It's how do we keep West Rock Hill looking like West Rock Hill? I mean, we had examples tonight. I mean, you get multiple warehouses showing up in an industrial area. That's an industrial area. It's a shame for people to live there, but it's the industrial area. But we see a lot of other projects come through, moving into the other side of Ridge Road, which is kind of like the borderline between the suburban part of the township and the rural part of the township.
Town, yes.
And, like, how do we, again, not to take away from people's rights, but how do we better protect so that your grandchildren and great-grandchildren will still recognize this township in the future?
Sure. And I think that's a valid point there. And I thought that we, you know, as long as I've been involved, and I spent 12 years on the planning commission before I became a supervisor, you know, 1.8 acres is a fair piece of ground. I mean, I know people that would give anything to be able to build a 1 acre. It almost being 2 acres for the north side of the township to be able to build a house on. I think I'm trying to decide, is this intended towards developers or is this intended towards property owners? The person that moves in West Rock Hill Town that has lived in a town and decides, okay, I can afford this piece of property, it's acre 2 acres or an acre 1.75 acres. And now he can't build a house there because, or she can't build a house there because we have an overlay system that won't allow that. But that's the only one that they could afford. Those are the people that I'm trying to represent and keep them in mind if something like this were to go forward and put in place. And not that we can't look at it.
What our thinking was really in terms of subdivision.
So you're looking at developers, actually.
Looking at developers. So where there's, as I said, when projects come through, it's 20 acres of forest, you chop it up into 10 different lots, and it's like, it's now a suburban township with trees on the lot. It's not a rural community.
But there are lands.
Or how do you separate, though? You're a citizen. No, you don't have to buy the property.
There are limits. So you can take an environmentally sensitive area with
in Bucks County and Southeast Pennsylvania, and you can put verbiage in a zoning ordinance recognizing the value of that and put additional protection on those forested areas. Fortunately for those of us who are on the Rock Hill, I'm one of them, God kind of took care of protecting it from cookie cutter development because it's too expensive to do all the rocks to be able to do it. But in spite of that, silviculture is a form of agriculture, and the board has recognized that you can protect agricultural resources. In this case, I could imagine that we could put additional protection on forested areas, but you cannot increase the minimum lot size over 1.8 acres, of course, the rules on that. Like, that's not even up for discussion. And because you don't want a minimum lot size that's so large that and when you use words like beautiful, courts don't like that either. Because they say zoning cannot be about aesthetics. It can't be about, it can be about preserving resources, but it can't be because we don't want to look at empty houses.
But there is a wording in that account that shall not be named that you can only cut down a certain percentage of trees.
You've got 90 ordinances.
We have that in our words.
Yeah. Do, but we don't, and not Pinnacum does, but maybe it's an angle that we don't necessarily require that to be a contiguous area. So it's not under Jimmy Top Road subdivision, you know, each lot cuts down their portion of trees that they're allowed to, and you end up not in one big forest area, you have trees that are in around all the fields. And I don't know, we can probably have further discussions on it, whether or not there might be a regulation where.
We can have further discussion, that's as much legal advice as I want to give it a public.
Yeah, right. But I'm saying,
okay.
Maybe that's kind of an aspect we could look at. Same thing like we do with open space. We don't want it, you know, 10-foot strips behind all the houses. So we want open space.
So let's have some discussion on it then. Okay?
Can I talk? Not now.
This is not public comment.
Okay. So it's only you guys discuss it and we.
That's right. We're discussing something that was brought up at the planning commission. When it's public comment, you'll be able to make your public comment. Okay? We're not there yet, but we're close. Okay. Moving forward. New business. Okay. I don't have any time. All right. Now. You've been waiting for public comment. If you have public comment, please state your name and address. Mr. White, you have 2.5 minutes. You may come up if you want.
Don White, West Rock Hill.
Your address, Don.
Why don't you guys give your addresses?
Well, you're speaking publicly. You have to give an address. My address is 231 Ridge Road.
Why shouldn't you guys? Well, everybody should give their address, right?
They
the
do.
Developers give
they,
their address?
They do give their address.
This has actually been argued already. Simon Campbell argued it. This is a First Amendment violation. You're doing it. And,
no.
Not
a First Amendment
violation. Simon Campbell took this to court. You don't have to give your address at public meetings.
Yeah.
Whatever. Yeah. Allentown Road. So, what I want to comment on is what was just discussed, is this matter with the zoning. I've said this at these council meetings in the past, I'm going to say it again. The zoning in West Rock Hill is out of control. You're doing way too much. You're controlling everything. I guess if I had a truck patch, I would have to get a soil permit to dig up my truck patch because I would be disturbing too much dirt. It just goes on and on. My father was instrumental in getting zoning in this township, and he was disturbed what it turned into. So now I'm at the point where I own 16 acres in West Rock Hill. I can't do anything with that property. I can't subdivide it and have children live on it. I can't do a thing with nothing. And I want to put an overlay district, I assume, and subject me to even stricter regulations. You know, we stand here at the beginning of the meeting and we pledge allegiance to the flag and we talk about liberty. It's not liberty, folks. This is not what it is. That's all. Thank you.
You're welcome. Anyone else have public comment?
Harry Lowell, 521,000 acre road.
Good evening, Harry.
To know with Jason Stoneback, what is the status on that?
This is public. public comment, not questions and answers.
Okay.
Public comment.
And the other thing, I would say is, Thousand Acre Road, there are several places where I'm assuming the trees came down, the township pushed the trees off and they're laying in the ditch, all on state game land. Township trucks up and down that road at least once a day. Why they stop, go get a backhoe, chainsaw, clear the ditch. We get a dog washer, you're gonna be losing the road.
Thousand Acre Road, you're saying?
Park.
This is on Thousand Acre?
Thousand Acre Road, right before Shady Lane, the short strip of, state game land, there's a tree about that, it's laying there. I'm assuming when it came down, township just pushed it off road in the ditch, I know. It's been there for several months now. And like I said, I see the truck walking down the road at least once a day. And that should be taken care of. And also, right below Carter's driveway, there's another tree laying there, which they put off to the side and it's laying in the ditch. Should be cut up and taken away. Alright?
Greg will look at it.
And also, Ridgeway Road, state game land's over there. I don't know, electric company, who it was, they came in there, cut back, drove, there's lots and everything laying in the ditch.
We've all seen that. That's a state road. That's an end of issue.
Alright, thank you.
You're welcome. Anybody else have a, yeah.
Good evening, Jim Miller, 916 Thousand Acre Road. I want to follow up on something Harry said. Went to the police station meeting last month, about almost 30 of us, complained about the issue, 2,000 acre road of noise. I want to make sure the township is aware of that. I know that the three supervisors were there and they're aware of it, but I want to make sure everyone else is aware of it. When we have explosions on 1,000 acre road that you can hear on Route 313 in Dublin, and you can hear all the way up to the Brick Tavern, that's a little too much for the residents to take. We have elderly folks there. We have animals there that are scared, that can be tranquilized. We just have a lot of things, and it's not going to get any better unless somebody takes action. So, we had one window broken because of it. It's just getting...
Okay, that's the, it must be very, very frustrating, but...
I don't want to comment.
It must be very frustrating, but like fireworks, the legislature has been very, very clear about what we can regulate and what we can't. And when we first heard about it, Greg called me and met with the chief and we looked into it. The Uniform Firearms Act does not give us the ability to regulate the use or possession or sale of firearms or ammunition. And what he's doing is considered ammunition. It's not considered blasting materials or something out of the normal. It certainly sounds out of the normal, but it falls within the Uniform Firearms Act, and the township does not have the ability to regulate that or enforce it.
Okay, I'm aware of that, but I'm also aware that the citizens should have a right to live peacefully. And when the noise is out of control, and when you have people driving up and down your street, and 2-3 years ago they were throwing beer cans up and down the road, parties and things like that, all of that, something has to be done to fix it for our street and for our residents. It's just out of control. And as we said in the police meeting, it's escalated. So, thank you.
I do want to correct you on something though, Jim. I have to do this because you said that there was 30 people there at that meeting. There was not 30 people there. I counted everybody that was in that room. You had 17 people at that meeting, not 30. I just want to make sure.
I said almost 30. I thought
yep.
It was around 23.
I counted them.
Okay,
and I think the chief did too.
Okay.
Okay?
Thank
you.
No problem there.
Yep.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Any other public comment?
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Alex Thornhill at 30,000 Acre Road.
Yes, sir.
Just going on the same comment, we just moved in. We're the new house on the road.
Okay.
Just commenting on, we moved to this township for a very